Hi, this is MCJetty for another episode of my automation tutorials for RFTools, RFTools Control, and XNet. A few things. I made a few changes to RFTools Control. For example, there is now a comment block. Very simple. It allows you to document your program, and you don't have to sneak to get to see the comment. It just shows it all the time, and otherwise it acts like a wire, so you can, your program can flow through it, but it won't do anything. Also, I added a new test equality. It's to test item equality. Check if the first item is equal to the second one. First of all, this was the program I explained last episode, where you had to store the item to compare in a variable, then do the comparison, and then do equality test on the result. Now this is much easier. You can directly test on the last item. Item 2 is iron ore, and you can even set things like metadata, NBT, and OR dictionary. So it's a easier and more flexible way to test for items. So now it's time to explain this device that I created. So basically, what does this do? First, well, let's first explain what we have here. So we have a storage scanner with a lot of storages in it, and the storage scanner currently contains ores, and apparently this one too, which is not really needed. Here you can see the contents. We don't have any processed ores, but we do have these. There's a power bank behind it, and then we have this. This device, if you insert an ore here, so let's take something. You immediately see gold ore being filled. Like that. Also, that's not the intention. It's apparently, it should only, it should not count the, yeah, that's better. Because the storage scanner was also scanning this one, but that's not one of the items it should be doing. So basically, this machine, which is controlled with XNet, is a lot of, it's not needed anymore. There's a lot of pulverizers and furnaces, and basically what happens is we have the input chest, and depending on the type of item, we have, for example, in these furnaces we accept these ores, in these pulverizers we accept these ores, in these ones we accept these ores in these pulverizers. So basically XNet is responsible for distributing the items over all the different machines. And so these are the ones that first pulverize and then melt. So if you can, they are connected to each other. That's weird. I thought this should have been nullified, given that this is there, or maybe it was there from earlier. Apparently, that one doesn't exactly work right. maybe a bug in terminal expansion. I don't know. Yeah, okay. So what's the goal of the program that we made? Basically, we want to process our ores depending on what we have and what we need. So we need more iron, so iron should get more priority. We don't need as much of these, so these shouldn't get as much priority. And of course also depending on how many ores we have. For example, we have very little platinum ore, so that's what this program should do. So we have our processor here. It also has a graphics card and a storage controls screen module. Okay, which still has a tooltip bug apparently. I need to fix that one. Hold on. Okay, this is better. So if you insert these modules, or the same modules that are used for the screen to display that, they're also the same modules that I installed in this one earlier. So they're modules that are used for a lot of things, and also RF2's control can use them. As soon as you insert one of these, you can use programs that access the storage system directly. Advanced network card, which is not really needed in this case, but it's to access that node. So let's see, how does a program work? It's a bit more complicated, as you can see. There are basically two programs. The first one, this one is easy. So what it does is, every 10 ticks, it tests if variable 3, which is the focus index. Oh yeah, for a continue. I should also explain this chest. So this chest contains crafting cards. Basically, every card, let's show one. It says go from iron ore to iron ingot. And here you see, so that's this one. And also it gives a number. So you see from iron, this gives iron ingot, just one. This gives 4 gold ingots, but that's not really true. Let's examine that one. Crafting cards are very general. You can set them up directly from J. So for example, if you have a recipe, another tooltip error. This one will not work, that's a special one. Say you have this one. So you can do that. But you can also say, you can give it any pattern and do something like that. That works too. It doesn't really care how you use this crafting card. You can use it to indicate input and output in some way. And what I did here was to say, okay, the number of gold ingots you get is actually, or platinum ingots, it's actually a priority. So I want most iron ingots, so that's set to lowest priority, which means most. In this case, it's the reversed. But I'm not as interested, for example, in diamonds, so that's a high priority. And I will explain you how this actually works. So it will use that priority, which I put in the crafting card, to decide how much of these I need and which ore should get priority. So these, if you want to add more ores, you can add more crafting cards to this chest. So the program will examine the chest And variable 3, focus index, is actually the index of the recipe of the crafting card that we are currently processing. So what do? We check if that variable has a good value, because if we are out of ORs, this will be set by the other program to -1. We examine the item up, so that's this chest. So we examine that item, that crafting card. We use the item from card function, because this opcode will return the crafting card as the last value, and then we can fetch the item, the destination item from it. So that will be iron ingot, gold ingot, platinum, and so on. Then we call this one get ingredients, and normally this one expects an inventory to check for ingredients, but if you have a storage module, then you can leave this empty and it will try to get the ingredients from storage. Yeah, this is the inventory of crafting cards, how to get the ingredients. This is the item we want to get the ingredients for, and this is the slot range where we put the ingredients. In our case it will be only one slot, but I put 3 for safety. So basically what that program does is to fill, and that program will be put here, is to fill this slot with the ores that we are currently focusing on. So that's the only purpose of this program. So the second program is a bit more complicated. So every 50 ticks, what will we do? What we want to do is to scan these, count how many of these items we have in the storage, multiply each of these counts with the number, the priority, and then set the focus to the one for which we have ores with the least, the lowest number. So this one, every 50 ticks we will do that. We start with an empty vector and we store that in variable in1. So that's the vector that will keep track of our count times priority. So then we start, we evaluate null, and we set the index variable to 0. Sorry, I say null all the time, that's Dutch, but I hope you get what I mean. And here, this is a loop. It's the first loop, and here we end the loop. Here, so you can see the green dots, it follows this, and it will continue here. So here we set the variable of the index, variable 0. And by the way, in the comment, so variable 0 is counter, vector with amounts, and length of vector. So we get the card, the crafting card from the chest above the processor. We test if it has a value, so if it's not the empty item, so we stop as soon as we are at the end of the chest. We get again like of the item from the card. We count how many items are in the storage system. We don't care about slots. This is the item to count. We set OR dictionary to true, and we only check the rootable, the start chests. So that's this one. We store that in variable 2. Then again we get same operation as here, the crafting card. We again get the item from that card, and we convert that to a number. And if you convert an item stack to a number, you get the count, and that's the priority. Then we multiply that priority with our amount. So for iron ingot, that means that we multiply with 1. For diamond, that means we multiply with 10. And that number we add to our vector. So the vector was in variable 1, and we add that integer, push integer to vector. So then we set that in variable 1, that vector, and then we add 1 to the index, and we loop again. So this will scan all the items, all the crafting cards, one by one, count how many of the desired results we have, and multiply it with the priority, so we get the vector of amounts times priority. If the loop ends, we go here, and then we come here, where we follow this path until we come at this opcode. So let's explain this part. Here we get the index again, that will be the last index, the length of our vector. And here we use special opcode. This generates a vector of indices. It means with this parameter, it will generate a vector 0, 1, 2, 3, up to this number. And I explain to you why I do this. It's here. That vector I sort, and I use the vector to use for comparison, the vector with our amounts as the sorting criteria. So the result of these two opcodes will be a vector containing the indices of the cards that I want to process first. For example, say I have no iron ingots, but that one is one with high priority. Then that iron ingot card, which is here, will be first. And that's what this one does. So I can't sort the vector with amounts, so variable 1 directly, because then I wouldn't know how to access the crafting card for it, because I would just get a sorted vector with no further information. So I need to sort the indices based on that vector. I hope you understand. It's a bit complicated, but it's the only way. But it's one way to do it. By the way, this vector sort, these two opcodes are also new for R2's control. You will not have them yet. But they're not essential. You could do this manually as well. It would just make the program a lot longer. So the result sorted vector we store in variable 1 again. Then we get 0, and we put that in the index variable. We get our vector. And yeah, that's that calculates, we convert that vector to an integer and subtract 1, that's the length. You could also, no, it's not here. Instead of this, it's not here that you can do that. It has to be another. Oh, yeah, I see. Yeah, okay. This is only number. Actually, I added the function to calculate the length, but you can't really use it here. I have to see how to do that. Then we set this length in variable 2. And this is a special operation, it's a loop. So loop a variable until it reaches a specific value. And so the value we will loop is variable 0, the index, which we set to 0, and we will stop at this vector inclusive. So that's why we have to do subtract 1, because if our length, in this case, we have 9 cards, so that we have to go from 0 to 8. In computer programming, one typically starts counting at 0. So this loop will execute this sequence for every value of that variable, and when it's done, it will execute this sequence. That's the end of the program. This is actually, if we have no more ors left, then we will come here and we will set the focus variable to -1, which will actually make this program not do anything. So that's how that works. Otherwise, we evaluate the vector and we get a specific item out of it. So that means we get the number, the index I mean. By the way, the variable that we store here is actually the vector of indices, because we sorted the indices. So here we get the first the index at this position, which should be the one we want, we are most interested in processing. We get the crafting cards, and here we count how many, that's a new output as well, we count how many crafts are possible using that crafting card from storage, the last crafting card, or dictionary true. So this will return a number of crafts that are possible. We are only interested if it's possible, so we test if it's greater than 0. If it's not greater, this will stop and the loop will continue for the next item. So this will do the loop. Otherwise, we will set this as focus, that means so we get our index again and we store that in variable 3. So that changes the focus. We log it. And here we do a few graphics operations. These, that's that rows. A box, and we get the item that we are currently rendering, and we display that on top of the box. By the way, to interpret colors like these, you can go to hexadecimal, so that means not transparent, red, green, blue. So that's how this works. And here we actually need to stop the program, because otherwise the loop will continue. So that's one of the few cases that you actually have to do the stop. So let's try the program now. Hopefully it works. Okay, so we are starting with iron. We do a bit of gold, a bit of platinum. So one by one we are processing redstone, lapis, and now we should continue probably with iron. Yes, so it's trying to evenly balance, and you can see here the item that it's currently focusing. We will not do any platinum anymore because we ran out of ores there. But basically it's working. It will now process all the ores. You see we got most iron ingots because iron ingot had most priority. And less diamonds because that's lesser priority. And in the meantime this is being processed. You can also, if you set this to a lower value, it will even go faster. This is okay already. Yeah, it did a few diamonds, you see. It's roughly, yeah, now it did a bunch of diamonds, but it's roughly 10 times the amount of iron ingot, because diamond at this priority. So this is a considerably more complicated program. But it shows the kind of automation that you can do with this. this program depends on storage scanners. So if you use a Python logistics or refined storage, you will need a way around that. One way could be to store this in a normal chest, and this as well, and then just use these, of course, and you can couple those two to the refined storage or Python logistics systems, because there's currently no way for RFDisk control to access items in a Python logistics or refined storage. Maybe in the future, but not right now. So RFDisk control has a few other things that you can use. For example, there are these modules. These allow you to interface RFDisk control with an RFDisk screen. So for example, this one allows you to do graphics from RFDisk control on a screen. It's for the console, that way you can show the console on the screen to interact with RFDisk control. This will send a signal. So that's one example for which this is useful. Let's quickly make an example here. And make it bigger like that. And then let's that we can show a variable. So okay, like that. So I set a target and then insert the modules, configure them, variable, index of the variable, and button. And signal clicked like that. Okay, and now let's see what was on this program. Oh yeah, there we have let's change this. That was the redstone thing, and use. And I already forgot, clicked. Clicked like that, and then this one, this one can stay. Test, I believe. Yeah, this is now, okay, it's an item, so let's click it, variable 1. Yeah, so you see, actually, let's add a bit more here, just to demonstrate. That and console. Okay. So you see how you can easily interact with RFDisk control by listening to signals with this. So that gives that gives a lot of possibilities. Signals, by the way, can also be used to have function calls. Call a function when the code is done executing, resume execution. Signal has to be defined on the same card. So you can make subroutines that way. For example, Let's make a subroutine of this. Print, let's call it print. And then you can here print like that, and that should work the same. Let's see. Yeah. So it still works. So that can sometimes be handy to for more complex programs where you have a certain thing. And actually it will also, after coming back, it will return here. So let's even go further. This should also work. I'm doing this both to test if it actually does, as to show how it works. Yeah, it still works. So after finishing the subroutine, it will return here. So if you have something more complex than just this operation, you can have whole code here and just call it from here. So that's what this is useful for. And this is actually useful for the iteration module that is this one, which in this case, yeah. Oh no, no, that's not this one. It's for the graphics module. When you have a button, let's actually show that as well. Let's add another screen. Like that. Oh, wrong button. Let's get the vector art module. Okay. And we need the graphics card now. Not this one, these from open computers, but this one is good. Okay. And let's make a new program. Let's make a drawing program. So whenever the user clicks on something, let's draw a line. Graphics operations have an ID, and that ID is used to sort them so that they are go from back to front. So let's draw a line from one corner to the last tuple, which will be set by this event, so that's where we have clicked. And let's make a green line. Drawing. Again, problem with the. Yeah. So let's check it out. So now you have a primitive drawing program like that. It only draws one line, because we actually replace the line every time. So to get a real drawing program, it would be a bit more complicated. Let me make something for you off screen first, and then I will explain it. Okay, so it turned out a bit more complicated. First, we have the signal. Init signal, this initializes our drawing program. It sets -1 to the two variables, and those represent the coordinates of the place we last clicked, and we want to initialize that empty. And we set variable 0 to an index, because there are a maximum of 30 drawing operations. We want to count how many we are already using. We will be using this variable as the index for the graphics operation. We also want to clear the graphics, so we have a clean slate. Whenever we click, we check. We store that position where we click to variable 3. We get the x, we compare it with minus 1. If it's not equal, we can draw from, we make an interval from the last click position, and we draw from that location to the location we just clicked on. And then we go back to here. This gets the last click position and stores the x coordinate in variable 0 and the y coordinate in variable 1, so that we remember where we clicked for the next time we click. And we get index variable, add 1 if it's greater than 29. Then if it's greater than 29, then we go here, we set it back to 0, otherwise we just store it. So that's the program. And now you can, with the sign, you can initialize it like that. It's empty now, and then you can draw. It's not the most impressive drawing program, but it should give an idea of how this works. Anyway, this wraps up this episode. I hope you liked it. We showed a few more advanced features of RevTools Control. I think I will have one more episode after this, because there's still a few things that we didn't cover. And yeah, I want to do that as well, like fluids and crafting station, old crafting system, and a lot more codes here. Also, inter-process communication, network identifiers, and tokens. So there's a lot more things that I have to explain, but that will be for the next episode. So see you next time. Bye bye.